until last month, I was the OpenShift solution architect at RedHat. I would work in the European area for clients implementing OpenShift as a proof of concept. And I'm here today to share my experience with those implementations. Since this is the Kubernetes meetup, I will start with Docker, then Kubernetes that's built that adds value to Docker, and then how OpenShift adds value to Kubernetes. Most of my presentation will be actually be a demo. The last presentation here in this gym, they talked about their platform as a service. One guy from the audience, he asked how to do database versioning in inside containers or inside days as platform as a service. So based on that, I decided to change this presentation a little bit and see how you could do database versioning inside Docker containers, or how a PaaS platform could help with that. And by demonstrating that, I am demonstrating all the capabilities of OpenShift that's added on top of Kubernetes. So we all know Docker, and we all know that it's really easy to package an application and to just run it somewhere. But the problem with just Docker is that you need more than just that if you want to run it in production. You need scheduling. If you have a cluster of hosts, you need to schedule a container somewhere on one of the nodes. You need lifecycle management. You would need service discovery and pod discovery. You would need monitoring of those pods. If they fail, you need some sort of scheduler to restart those pods somewhere else. Authentication and scaling. Auto-scaling or behind a load balancer. So Kubernetes was introduced as the cluster manager, the scheduler for Docker containers. But we need more than just this cluster management. If you are working in an enterprise, you would want a lot more. For OpenShift facilitates DevOps, and what that means is the developers will have a self-service portal where they can just request some project space where they can host and build their own Docker containers. You would have like a service catalog where other developers or operations people can put their applications in, and then other developers can just use those applications like a service catalog. OpenShift is a platform as a service, so it not only hosts your Docker container, but it also can build your Docker container. And we have a lot of builder images for that. We support a lot of languages like PHP and Java. The key here is automation. Everything needs to be automated. So you would automate the building of your application into a Docker image. It's called source to image, which is automated. And after that, you need to automate the deployment of your application into the cluster. And after that, you need to monitor those applications. And OpenShift does all of that. So DevOps collaboration. Security is very important for Red Hat. Where in Kubernetes, you can just run a pod. In OpenShift, it could be a little bit more challenging. We don't allow by default to run containers privileged, and the user that you specify in a Docker file is not the user that's what your container runs on in OpenShift. OpenShift replaces that user with a random high numbered user, so that you by default cannot be root in a Docker container, because in a Docker file you can just specify user zero, user root. OpenShift by default doesn't allow that. OpenShift is flexible enough to say you can override that, but by default, security by default. And of course, we have a lot of integrations with stuff like LDAP, Active Directory, so that the developers, the users that are already present in your corporation can just use, can just be specified as users within OpenShift. Integrated load balancing until last month, Kubernetes did not have a router, a reverse proxy. From day one, OpenShift did have that. Open source. So,
is it open source?
Yes. So there are three flavors of OpenShift. OpenShift Origin is the open source upstream version. You have OpenShift Enterprise, which is exactly the same version, but then with commercial support. And you have OpenShift Dedicated, which is a managed, hosted version of OpenShift, hosted on Amazon, managed by Red Hat. Okay, when you start with OpenShift, if a developer logs in, the first thing that he does is he creates a project. And a project is just a sandboxed environment, a playground for the developer to work in. And it's like a security boundary at the network level, at the authorization level. Everything a developer does within a project is the same as a Kubernetes namespace. Everything you do in that project, in that namespace, he can do whatever he wants. He is constrained by the limits that an operations guy imposes on that namespace, on that project. So, for example, he cannot use more than so many CPU or memory, or he cannot create more than so many pods or whatever. So, what I like to say is ops is in control because they define the boundaries. But dev has the freedom to do whatever they want in their project. This is the Kubernetes meetup, so I assume you know what a pod is. But what is important to know is it's a grouping of containers. It's a single deployable unit. So usually, or a good example would be that you would deploy WordPress and MySQL in the same pod because WordPress cannot live without MySQL. So you would think that's a good combination, but actually it's not, because if you use auto-scaling, you might want to scale the front-end differently than the database. If you want to deploy a new version of WordPress, you don't want to restart your MySQL database. In this presentation, this demonstration, I've tried to demonstrate database versioning. So, so what I've tried to do is I've tried to create a JBoss, Wildfly, Docker image, and I've tried to create a Wildfly Docker image. Wildfly is the tool that supports database versioning. Initially, I tried to put that in one pod. I ended up with building one container, one pod that has JBoss and Wildfly in one image. But the idea was separately. The idea was that I would create one container called Flyway, and I would mount a Git repository as a volume inside this container, and the Git repository would have the SQL scripts to execute to update your database. And the idea was that this container, Flyway, would be triggered to run just before running the JDOS image using a pre-deployment hook, a feature of OpenShift. Okay, Kubernetes can host images, it can host containers, but OpenShift can build those images. How does that work? We have a process we call source to image. And what we do is, when you define a new application in OpenShift, you define two things. One is your Git repository where your source code is, and two, the base image on which you want to base your application. So in this case, I have an application in my Git repository. I have a JBoss quick start called greeter. He will greet you. And I will specify that this source code needs to be built on top of the JBoss EAP Docker image. So combining those two, what OpenShift does, it will just start this JBoss EAP image. Inside this JBoss image, you will have your build tools like Maven. In your Git source repository, which is Git cloned into this running Docker container, you will find your pom.xml, and Maven will just compile that into a WAR file or whatever and put the resulting WAR file as a new layer on top of this base JBoss image. And this new image with your WAR file is then uploaded to the private Docker registry that comes with OpenShift. We support a lot of languages by default, but you can also write your own builder image. And what's interesting to know is that OpenShift supports triggers. So when you've built an image and it's uploaded to the Docker registry, after that's uploaded, that can trigger a deployment. Because the deployment configuration will have an image change trigger and will just watch the Docker registry for any changes on that image. And if it sees a new image uploaded, it will deploy that. You can use triggers, but you can also decide not to use it and manually deploy. You are flexible. This is an example of a build configuration, if you can read it, where you specify your source code and you specify your base image and you specify the target image. If you push this YAML or JSON configuration into the API of OpenShift, OpenShift will start to build this as an image. After the image is uploaded to the Docker registry, it needs to be deployed in the cluster. So we have a deployment configuration that specifies which version of your Docker image you want to deploy, what kind of strategy you want to use for deployments, like rolling updates, or you just want to go with a big bang. You can specify your pre and post deployment hooks, which I will demonstrate in my demo. And you can specify the triggers, like the image change trigger. If the build has uploaded a new image, it will automatically be deployed. This deployment configuration will automatically create a replication controller. And the replication controller is the same as the deployment, only then version specific. So if I have my app here, I would have my app version 1 as a replication controller and my app version 2 as a replication controller. And then it can do rolling updates by scaling up one replication controller and scaling down the other replication controller. And of course the replication controller will create pods. So this is an example of a deployment configuration where I would specify I want to have a replica of 2, which is just copied to the replication controller. I am specifying that this template is the template for the replication controller, basically the template for the pods. And I specify the triggers when I want this deployment to be triggered. On this image change trigger, but also on, for example, on the configuration change trigger. If I change the image here that I don't specify latest, but version whatever, I change the configuration, it will automatically deploy that image. So the deployment strategy, like I mentioned, you could, the default is rolling updates. So if you have 5 containers running, it would start a 6th container with a new version, and when that's up and running, by health checking it says I'm up and running, it will shut down one of the old versions, and then it will keep on doing that until you have 5 containers of the new version. During this deployment, you can specify pre and post deployment hooks. And my idea was that I would specify in the pre-deployment hook running flyway. That would do the database updates. I cannot, for example, I cannot in the post deployment hook, I could say tag an image. And what this does is if you tag an image, you change the image, which triggers an image change. So tagging an image can trigger a deployment. So if I tag an image, which is tagged as test, but now I tag it as prod, that can trigger a deployment in production. And that way, we can do image promotions from develop to test to acceptance to production. So those triggers are quite important. Okay, services, I assume you all know this, Kubernetes meetup. The service really is a load balanced virtual IP address. So with that you could scale your pods, and the virtual IP address and will just stay there. This also facilitates service discovery, because those services, those IP addresses, get translated into a DNS name that your application can just use. For example, in my PHP application, I could say just connect to the DNS entry called DB if I have a service called DB. It also does service discovery in environment variables, where you would have an environment variable called DB host and DB port, so that you can look up that service through environment variables. And I will use in my demo these environment variables to look up an external Oracle database. In normal situations, the service is a load balanced virtual IP address with, in the back end, those pods. Normally those pods, how does the service know which pods it needs to target? It does that by labels. Every object in Kubernetes has a label. In this case, I am defining an external service. So this external service, an Oracle database, is not within the OpenShift cluster, so it doesn't have a label. What I'm doing is I will specify endpoints, hard-coded IP addresses that are linked to this service. By doing that, I pull that external service into the OpenShift cluster, because a service defined in OpenShift facilitates this service discovery. this service gets translated into a DNS entry and into environment variables, so that any application hosted inside OpenShift can use that external service through service discovery. The other thing that OpenShift has is we call it a router, but Kubernetes calls it Ingress. Basically, it's a reverse proxy that can do SSL offloading, and based on the virtual host name, it will route, and based on the context path, it can route. By default, we use HA proxy to do that, but you can replace that with anything you like to host yourself, because it's a Docker image. For example, we've created a F5 big IP, which is not an F5 big IP inside the Docker container, but it's just the agent that would connect to the API of an F5. But by specifying a router of type F5, you can export all your services and all your routes to a real F5 big IP. Okay, if this is the normal Kubernetes architecture, where you would have the pods running on a node with a service in front of that and an ingress router in front of that, what OpenShift will add is the build configuration, building the Docker images. It adds also this deployment configuration, where nowadays Kubernetes also has a deployment object type, but the deployment configuration object of OpenShift has a lot more features like these pre and post deployment hooks. And that was available from day one. And now, since last month, Kubernetes added the same thing. For your information,
is it the same or is it?
No, it's different. So okay. It makes it incompatible with Kubernetes.
Okay.
In my opinion, and I hope OpenShift will change that and make it compatible.
Only a question.
Security is very important for Red Hat, so we added a lot of policies to make it more secure, to not run your Docker containers as root by default, stuff like that. And we added a web console. If you want to do DevOps and you want to do this self-service thing for developers, you want a portal that developers can log into and just order containers or order applications. So we added the concept of projects, which is Kubernetes namespace, but really here it's a requirement to use projects to really define a sandboxed environment, so that not one pod can kill a complete node with other pods because it uses too much resources. And the last thing is, we have OpenShift software-defined network, which really integrates as a plugin into OpenShift itself. What it does is, if you create a new project, you create a VXLAN on the overlay network. So OpenShift SCN is basically using Open vSwitch, but it integrates with OpenShift to create these VLANs. Okay. So I'm running this demo in a virtual box, and all I basically did is yum install Docker engine and then Docker run OpenShift. That's how easy it is to run OpenShift, because it's just one Docker image that you can run. In normal production clusters, OpenShift clusters, you don't run OpenShift in the Docker container, but you would install a complete cluster. I didn't run, my command wasn't as simple as Docker run OpenShift. It was actually this long. So what I will do in this demonstration is I will create a few Docker images. Basically, I'm using the JBoss EAP image from Red Hat. On top of that, I modify that image to conform to my enterprise company standards. I'm using Oracle, so I want to include Oracle JDBC driver into this Docker image. And then I'm creating a new image with Flyway on top of that. And lastly, I'm creating my greeter application, and that will use Flyway in the end as the base image. So the first thing that I'm doing is I will create a new project. I call it the JBoss project. And what I'm doing here is I will create a build configuration to build my my JBoss image with the Oracle driver included. If you look here, okay, so I will create an image called JBoss EAP Oracle, and it's based on my Git repository, JBoss EAP Oracle. Basically, what that in this repository, I have a Docker file, and so this Docker file says copy the modules directory into this image, and in this module directory I have the Oracle JDBC driver. So I can do OC create, and then I specify this file, and it created two things, an image stream and a build configuration. OC get build configuration, I'm seeing here my build configuration. So I can do, for example, OC export build configuration, JBoss EAP. Here I have my exact same object. So I want to start a new build. And what this does is it will git clone the repository that I've specified in my build configuration. And in that git repository it will find a Docker file, and it will just do a Docker build based on that Docker file. As you can see here. And then when it's finished building this image, it will push it to the internal Docker registry. So that's how simple it is to build an application in OpenShift. But we will make it a little bit more complex. So we now have a Docker image, and we want to expose this Docker image for other developers to be able to use that as their base image. So by default, everything is secure. I've created a project called JBoss, and nobody can access what's inside this project, and this project can also not access anything outside of this project. So I need to define a policy to make it possible for others to view this image and use this image as their base image. So I define a policy. Add role to group. I say image puller, because then you can pull the image to all the authenticated users in OpenShift. Okay, so then, so I'm now another developer, and I create a project space called My App, and I want to define an application that uses as a base image this JBoss Oracle image. So I say new app, and I say the image that I want to use is JBoss Oracle, because project space JBoss, and the name of the image is JBoss EAP Oracle. and then I simply specify my Git repository where my source code is. And I specify a reference which can be a tag or a branch or whatever. So you see what it did is it did quickly a Git clone of that Git repository. It looked inside and it tried to determine what kind of application it is. It sees that it uses now, it says it matches JAA, so Java. And for Java, by default, it would use a JBoss EAP image, but I've overwritten that with our custom JBoss EAP image. It creates a build configuration to build your application, and it creates a deployment configuration, a service, all the objects within OpenShift that you would need to host and to build this application. OC, get build configuration, deployment configuration. You see those are all created. So it created this application and it immediately started to build this application. And it sees that it has a pom.xml, so it knows it has to compile using Maven. And it's busy doing that now. Will take a while, but when this is finished, it will produce an image called myop, and uploading that to the Docker registry will trigger a deployment. So it will, once this is built, it will deploy. If anyone has any questions, now is a good time to ask.
I have one.
Yes.
I've seen a settings.xml.
Exactly. Yeah. So that is part of this example. You take the basic JBoss EAP image, which does not have any settings.xml for Maven. So in almost every company, you want to customize the settings.xml. Therefore, almost always, you will want to customize this JBoss EAP image to your liking. You can add and override any file that you would need. I added the Oracle JDBC driver as a JBoss module. I added settings.xml for Maven, and I added some mirrors. And I modified the standalone.xml that's used in OpenShift. And I added some service discovery magic.
Is it possible to remove it? That was my question. So I assuming no. That the settings XML contains some information that I don't want to keep in an image that is prepackaged. I want to clean it, right?
You can overwrite it with an empty settings.xml.
At the end of the image creation, meaning this has created now an image, right?
Yeah.
And there will be a settings XML there.
Yes.
And it's not possible on a post image creation to clean it up.
But what you can do is myop, this application, you are the developer of myop.
Yes.
And you would use this JBoss EAP Oracle as a base image. If you want to override settings.xml, you would simply specify that in myop, because the producing image is called myop. So you can override anything that you want. Okay, so the image is pushed to the Docker registry, and that should have triggered a deployment. OC get pods, where I am seeing that the build pod has completed building, and there's now a runtime pod with JBoss and with your WAR file in it. I can see here that that JBoss has started. So I have a service, but services are meant internally for in the cluster. So if a visitor from outside wants to access this application, I need to expose this service as a route. I need to expose it to the router as a virtual host. So I can simply say OC expose this service, JBoss greeter, with the host name, greeter.example.com. And now I have a route. Now I can go to my browser. And I have my application here. But the application is trying to access a data source called my Oracle, and it's not there. So we have to add this Oracle service into the OpenShift cluster, and we have to expose it through service discovery into this JBoss image as a data source configured in JBoss. So this is some service discovery magic that will happen. Based on the environment variables a service will expose into the JBoss container, we will configure a data source in JBoss. So we need to define a service. So I have an Oracle service here. I have an Oracle service here, listening on port 1521, and I specify endpoint fixed endpoint IP addresses. So if I do OC create Oracle, it creates those objects. So I now have a service called my Oracle, and this will be exposed as environment variables inside the JBoss greeter container. I just need to tell this JBoss image which services I want exposed as data sources inside the JBoss container, because not all services within a project you want that defined as a data source. So I will add some parameters, some environment variables to the deployment config. So I have here environment variables. This simply specifies the database services prefix mapping. It specifies which service I want mapped as a data source in JBoss. Every environment variable that starts with my will be used as extra information that is not exposed through the service. The service exposes the host IP address, and it specifies the TCP port, but it doesn't specify a username or a password and any other information how to build this data source. So that is added as environment variables.
This is within the project, right?
This is within the deployment configuration of the JBoss container.
Okay. Yeah.
So we have here containers. This is the container that we are running, JBoss greeter. And to this container, we add these environment variables. And when the container starts, it doesn't start JBoss immediately. It starts a script first. And this script does all the magic of composing a new standalone.xml for JBoss, including the Oracle data source. So I can say OC get deployment configurations, OC edit deployment configuration, JBoss greeter. So. Okay. Because I have modified the configuration of this deployment configuration, and you can see it has a trigger called config change, it will automatically start to deploy the new container. You can see now Greeter 2 is running.
Yeah, above it there is the deploy running.
Yeah, so it will start with the deployment container, which will deploy the actual container. So this is the bash script that is executed, and so it executes generate data source as a bash function, but that will generate this XML template, and in the end we will simply do something like a search and replace of a placeholder with the actual XML data source. And then, once that is finished, it will start the JBoss.
Short hint?
Yeah.
5 minutes.
Yeah. So. So now, when I reload my application, it actually finds the data source. But it says there are no tables in it. So now we add Flyway to the Docker image to actually execute some SQL scripts. I have in my Git repository, I have resources SQL. I have here two SQL scripts that will do a create table and insert some users into it. So now I have to create this Docker image with Flyway in it. So I will go back to the JBoss project. Flyway. And here this Git repository also has a Docker file, and the Docker file will be based on the JBoss EFP Oracle image. And then it will it would download Flyway and install it into the Docker image. So I can say OC create. Wait, I would do OC new app. Method as a base image. Flyway. No. And I say I end with a dot. And so in my last command with OC new app, I specified the complete URL for the Git repository. But if I have already checked out this Git repository, I can just specify the directory where this Git repo is checked out, and it will get all the Git information from the Git config that's there. So it has now created a build configuration called Flyway. And you can see the Git repository being used. Okay. I have to fix something. I say OC start build. So this will basically execute this Docker file. It will take the Oracle, the JBoss Oracle as the base image. It will add Flyway to it and then push this image to the Docker registry. So in the in my Gritor application, once this is finished building, I want to add this as the base image for my application so that I have flyway. I can say edit the build configuration, and I say replace Oracle by flyway. So my flyway image is still being built, and this will take a long time. And then that, because we have these image change triggers, and I have specified an image change trigger, and as a base image I'm using this flyway image. So as soon as the build finishes of this flyway image and it's uploaded to the Docker registry, that will trigger a build of my application. Once the build of my application is finished, that will automatically trigger a deployment. The deployment, in the deployment I will add now a pre-deployment hook that will actually execute flyway to parse those SQL scripts. So in my strategy, in my rolling update strategy, I will add a pre-deployment hook that will execute my container with the command flyway migrate. Oh, see, added deployment configuration. Yeah, I add that. So. So the flyway Docker image is still being built, and there's not enough time to complete this, but with that pre-deployment hook that will execute flyway, flyway will execute those SQL scripts that are packaged in the WAR file. It will fill the Oracle table, and if I reload my application, it would actually show the users that I've inserted into the table. So with a little bit magic, you can do very crazy things with OpenShift. As Kubernetes is very flexible, OpenShift is even more flexible with a DevOps and a developer mindset in mind, where you want to create your continuous delivery pipelines. You can do that with these triggers and these hooks that I've shown. So I've shown you this JBoss EAP image that already has the magic of service discovery, where you would define a service in your project and that would get mapped to a data source inside JBoss. That's already there. All the JBoss middleware products that Red Hat has have been containerized and optimized for running on top of OpenShift with stuff like this service discovery magic. CloudForms is a manager of managers of clouds. CloudForms can manage your OpenShift nodes. CloudForms is meant to manage the infrastructure. It supports like VMware, it supports OpenStack, It supports cloud providers like Amazon and Azure, but it also supports container providers like OpenShift. By using CloudForms, which comes for free with OpenShift, you can do auto-scaling on the infrastructure level, meaning that if your cluster is full of containers, you can have CloudForms trigger the provisioning of a new virtual machine that gets provisioned as OpenShift added to the cluster, then you have new capacity to deploy your container.
Also downscale?
Yeah, sure. This is based on events and triggers, and so if it gets an event that it's overutilized or underutilized, it can do a certain action. You are very flexible here that you can script whatever you want. Okay. And we have a complete suite, Red Hat Cloud Suite for Applications, where you could bundle all the Red Hat products, like you would use OpenStack, you could use OpenShift on top of that, you could have CloudForms manage all of it together. So you can buy it as a bundle, you know it's compatible and it just works. Okay, that's it for me. Any questions?
I was following. How do you integrate this with any other DLT, for example? So if you have Jenkins or any other environment?
Yeah. So for Jenkins, we have a plugin, an OpenShift plugin, where you can just trigger a build, trigger a deployment, a few other actions. So that's the easiest way to integrate with Jenkins, but it can integrate with any CI tool, because just like Kubernetes, OpenShift has an API. You can just talk to the API, you can use the OpenShift command line tool, OC, like I did. Or you can directly talk to the API, which is RESTful. So
you're able to use the OC command remotely, or is this?
Yeah, what I did should be shown as remotely. I can also do OC remote shell into a container from my laptop to a container running in the cloud or in your private data center. I can do also port forwarding, where I want to, if I run this JBoss Docker image somewhere in the cluster, and it just exposes port 80 HTTP, but I want to connect to the JVM debugging port, I can just port forward directly to that debugging port on that container. And we also integrate with Eclipse. We have a plugin for Eclipse where you can do all of that stuff from within your IDE. You can start a build, you can see the logs of your build and your container, but you can also do this stuff like port forwarding. Okay? Yeah?
The people of Google, they are not so fond of VXLANs. Level 3 routing is what they...
As Kubernetes moves more and more to this CNI network plugin stuff, OpenShift will do the same. And more plugins, network software-defined network plugins or whatever network plugins, more and more of those will be developed. For example, we already have an OpenStack Neutron plugin. So you don't have to create an overlay on an overlay, in the future it will be possible if, for example, you have a Cisco plugin, that OpenShift will just create a VLAN on Cisco. I'm sure that's coming. So, but for now, the important thing to know is that we wrote this software-defined network plugin for OpenShift to facilitate this security, where you create a project, you create a VXLAN. If you use something like Flannel, you create just a flat network, And if you have different projects, they can just access each other if you know the IP address.
Unless they are not routable. And you have no layer 2 connectivity, then...
No, on the overlay network, they are routable.
You had the build configuration file, and in that file you had to copy some environment variables. So let's say we have two deployment pipelines, production and test, for example. Is the build configuration file also part, can you also define parameters?
Yeah, the normal thing what you would do is you define a separate project for dev, a project for test, and a project for production. You would have individual different build configurations for your dev, test, and production environment. They would look very similar, but they can differ a little bit based on maybe the image tag or environment variables, or like your database connection will be different, that kind of stuff. You would have to, you would define two build configurations in two different projects.
Last one?
Yeah, last one.
You mentioned an overlapping feature with Kubernetes, right? The scheduling that was introduced a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
Do you see this as a threat for the future of OpenShift? Meaning, is there going to be more overlap, and how do you see this being complementary?
So, with Kubernetes 1.2, we create a lot of incompatibility was created. And Red Hat is the biggest contributor to Kubernetes, and I would have expected the deployment configuration in OpenShift to be incorporated in Kubernetes. They decided not to do that. I don't know the reason why, but this, to me, this is really a problem that needs to be addressed, and I'm sure OpenShift will address this. I just don't know how.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.